So let me start out by saying I like metaphors. There are going to be plenty of metaphors here, but we'll start with the first one. So just imagine, as you sleep soundly inside your home at night, there's a robot at your front door. Now this is a special robot, right? This robot can manufacture and test keys to your lock, one by one in rapid succession. What do you think is going to happen? Eventually it's going to get in, right? Because there's only so many permutations of keys. Now, imagine that once it's inside, it replicates itself, and it senses the offspring out to all your neighbors, and eventually your entire city is going to be overrun with these robots, and then your state, your country, eventually the whole world, right? Like, this is dramatic, sure, but, you know, far-fetched?
Yeah.
But it's exactly what's happening right now in a digital sense, right? So malware are sent to all these servers, and they break in. They test every password and every login possible. Eventually, they find their way into a small percentage of machines. They replicate, and they continue to spread. So this happens on WordPress logins. It's nasty. It happens every day. It's a little less prevalent now, but, you know, it's still good. So what's the end game, right? Like, what's the benefit of doing that? In a lot of cases, we don't really know, right? We've seen malware sit dormant on people's servers for years. Those are the scary ones. We'll talk about them later. Sometimes it's really trivial, right? Ads are injected. You know, hackers can profit materially from putting ads on your site. So sometimes sites are defaced or deleted, political protests. Sometimes they're told to mine cryptocurrency. I've seen that. Sometimes they're simply used as like nodes in massive distributed denial of service attacks. That's a really common one. The possibilities are endless, right? Once they're in there, they can do what they want. So who am I? I'm Rich Collier. I work at Automatic. I'm on the Jetpack team. I focus specifically on WordPress and Jetpack Rewind, which are two of Automatic's security-focused products. I spent a lot of time looking at and fixing badly hacked sites, and sites that don't even look hacked sometimes, but are very badly compromised. So, prior to Automatic, I was chief technology officer of a fairly large local media company. So I had my claws pretty deep into the security world. Lastly, kind of out in left field, I build and fly open source racing drones. So I'm pretty passionate about the security of those as well. Yeah, don't get me started on airports. I love security. There's insecurities everywhere. It's scary. So why should security matter, right? Like, none of us are Google or Facebook, right? Like, who cares? Well, that's true, but there are hundreds of breaches that don't make the news every year that completely crush small and medium businesses, right? Like, reputation damage. In fact, the mere mention of a breach like this on, like, Twitter, social media, it can be detrimental to a business. It puts people out of business. What's more, you could be held legally liable in certain cases, right? If you expose user data, like, you know, most of us aren't collecting social security numbers or whatever, but, you know, those of us that do, you know, that's a problem, right? We have to protect that data. Look at the cases brought against Facebook and Google, right? Like, you're not immune because you're a small business. In fact, I'm not a lawyer. I don't really know anything about law. But I would say it's possible your business is more at risk if you are not prepared to defend yourself if something happens. It's a very sensitive time for data privacy and security, and cases continue to be brought in front of judges, you know, all over the world, trying to figure out who is responsible for this stuff ultimately, right? Like, we have laws on the books in some places, but not everywhere, right? We don't know. There's still some arbitration that needs to happen before we know who is responsible for what. Have any of you seen Black Mirror on Netflix? Okay, so this is an interesting one. There is, I think it's the first episode of the third season, maybe? It's called Nosedive. And the premise of this is essentially, like, a society where, like, social status is as important as a credit score or financial status, something like that. So, obviously, it's exaggerated in that show for cinematic purposes, whatever. But we are not that far from a world where Facebook data, you know, is more private than a credit score to people, right? So I'm using Facebook as a sort of analogy here, but it can apply to any data, right? Like, go to a WordPress site and you get a like on something, right? Like, what if that's a like that you want other people to see and you want to know what's happening when you click that like button, right? So, again, in a lot of cases, this data, whether arbitrary or not, can be more personal than financial data. As a site operator, developer, designer, we need to think about all of these things when we're putting our businesses and our blogs and our customers online, right? Ask yourself, what personal data are we collecting? Do we even need to collect this data? Are we aware of what that data is, right? Like, it's easy to go, you know, install this plugin and install that theme, and you have no awareness of what it's doing in the background, right? There's no simple solution for that if you're not a developer. We'll get more into that later. But, yeah, think about your data if you have any awareness of it, right? Like, could this data be damaging to someone's reputation? You know, could it be used to harass someone, drain a bank account, identity fraud? You know, these are mostly extreme cases, admittedly. But imagine if a hacker tried stealing WooCommerce data out of your site, right? Like, what are you selling on your site? Could this be damaging to someone's reputation? I don't know, but, you know, possibilities are endless here, again. So, breaches can be significant. More often than not, they're pretty bad. Sometimes they're not that bad. So, usually they can cause, you know, at the very least, cause damage to a reputation, right? Like, once that data's on the black market, it provides an advantage to competitors and I think they're not looking. I mean, obviously I'm talking about the bigger businesses here, but again, applies all the way down to small businesses. Hacked sites, this is a big one. I'm gonna talk more about this shortly. Hacked sites can lead to blacklisting on the search engines, right? Like, Google will put you in their crosshairs and it's very difficult to get out of that, right? Customers may never trust the business again. Increased bounce and churn because of that. Directly stolen money or, you know, assets. We don't see that as often anymore, but it does happen. So, intellectual property, not typical possibility though. You know, but again, what data are you storing? You know, is this proprietary? What's going to happen if your competitor gets their hands on this data? So, let me talk about some numbers here. These are pretty rough numbers. There's no real resource for this aggregate data, but close to 20,000 sites per month have been compromised this year. Again, you can argue about the numbers, but this is the best estimate I could come up with. Nearly 90%, let me say that again, nearly 90% of compromised sites are running WordPress or Joomla. Okay, let that sink in. Additionally, WordPress, if you haven't heard, powers more than 30% of the top million sites. It's got a huge market share, right? So that makes it a great target for the bad guys. Over 80% of attacks, let me clarify, over 80% of attempted attacks are brute force type attacks, like I was talking about with the robot earlier. That doesn't mean they're all successful, but that's the numbers of attempts that we're seeing. So, research shows, generally speaking, no one practices strict password security. Sure, I'm going to go off on a tangent. So, as I said earlier, I used to be the CTO of a media company. We had about 200 employees. I did a security audit one day, and I decided I'm going to find out how secure people's passwords are. So, I pulled up Jack the Ripper, and I pulled out the password hashes, and I cracked over two-thirds of these media employees' passwords. So, okay, cool. You tell them to change their password or whatever. Send them some supporting information. Please update your password. About 2 weeks later, I did it again. No one had updated their password. Or maybe some did, but they weren't any more secure. Right? The reality here is people don't even understand well enough to select an appropriate password that is appropriately secure. also add my passwords in the list. I thought it was good. So, also, WordPress themes and plugins are created and distributed every day, you know, freely. There are plenty on the theme and plugin repositories online. They don't really go through any sort of substantial security review, right? Like, so, of that, I haven't really seen this happen, to be honest. I'm surprised, but in theory, a bad guy can upload whatever plugin they want, and people can download and use it, and their site's compromised. Right? Like, trust no one. Trust nothing. Even in that case, again, I haven't seen it happen, and I do know that if that did happen, the plugin would get pulled pretty quickly, but, yeah. Let's see here. Okay, I don't usually do it, but I have no notes on this slide. Like, I'm just going to read the bullet points because these are important points. More than half of the top million sites do not have an SSL certificate or have it misconfigured somehow, such that it's not effective to somebody who knows what they're doing. Most attacks are automated. Right, like it's not some kid in his basement like hacking into your site. These are literally malware spreading and scanning, doing nefarious things autonomously. Many of them state sponsored. I'm not going to go into that. Attack targets and attack vectors are nearly endless. I'll elaborate on this shortly. If you think you're not susceptible because like you're just running WordPress and a couple plugins or whatever, you're very mistaken. Thank you, Dave. We'll elaborate on that one as well. Every business is vulnerable. Any business that you think could possibly be targeted has likely already been infiltrated. I will expand on this one as well. Let's talk about attack vectors. Just out of curiosity, like how many technical versus users, how many like developers are there? Okay, and then the rest of you, I'm assuming, are just like users or power users. Okay, so I'm going to explain what an attack vector is. It's really just kind of a fancy way of saying, like, this is how a hacker can get it. This is what's vulnerable or susceptible to attack. The definition is a path or means by which a hacker can gain access to a computer or a network server in order to liberate payload or malicious outcome. Attack vectors enable hackers to exploit system vulnerabilities, including the human element. So, this last point, the human element. Though it's the last part of the definition and almost an oversight, this is very important. We're going to come back to this. So here's some common attack vectors. Just throw some more numbers at you here. Host vulnerabilities are about 41%. So this includes like your host software they're running. If you have a shared host, there's some bleed sometimes. If somebody gets attacked and they're on the same machine, depending on the circumstances, they can find your way. Vulnerable theme code is 29%. Vulnerable plugin code is 22%. And password cracking and things of that nature is roughly 10%. This is in terms of how somebody successfully compromised the site. So again, look at these numbers. Between themes and plugins, that's over 50% of attacks get in from a bad theme or a bad plugin. Again, it sounds like you may have to have like some obscure combination of things, right? Here's another metaphor for you. It's kind of like how a trained police officer can find something to pull you over for, because they are trained to know how to spot these things. Same thing in computer security, right? The hackers know exactly those weird combinations of things, or logic errors, or they know exactly what vulnerabilities are in which versions of plugins and themes. They're the experts at finding these things. So, quickly, let's talk about how to identify a hack site, right? Sometimes it's pretty clear, right? You go to your site, it's been defaced, it's been deleted, it's not there, it's redirecting, whatever. Sometimes it's not really clear, right? Like, there's no apparent change. 10% of major breaches go undetected. Sometimes for years. Now, this is the Sony and the Facebook thing. It's like, they didn't notice for a while. Here's a defaced site. It's pretty obvious the site was hacked. Many times it's pretty cheesy. Here's another example. and another. This one's a little more political. You're going to see something that doesn't look right. Okay. Sometimes you see a bunch of advertisements. This is pretty common. A site will have anywhere from like a small ad somewhere put on it to like pop-ups and garbage everywhere. And like, I see this a lot working with Jetpack. Like when we work on customer sites that have been hacked. Like, this is a pretty, you know, common one. Malware warnings, God knows what else. We see a handful of redirections also. You head to your site and it redirects to another domain. Sometimes that has nothing really to do with your server, and it's your DNS settings or something. Like, there's a ton of different things that can happen here, but you go to your site, it's not there. You've been redirected to another site. That happens. Usually that site's loaded with gnarly advertisements or malicious software, you know, everything I already explained. Pretty awful. It's completely broken. There's nothing there. Get it there. Sometimes a malware is like embedded directly on your site, you know, pop up like download this from whatever.com. Don't hit download. Most browsers have like protections in place against this now, but like hackers are kind of always a step or two ahead. Like, they're just going to continue to do these things, even if they're only temporary. Performance could decline. You go to your site, it's taking forever to load. Does load, it doesn't look like there's anything wrong. Typically, we don't see this when your site was the target. Like, really, they were after your host, like the server that's hosting your site. They want to use system resources to mine bitcoins. See that one. Or, you know, distributed denial of service attacks. Again, they'll use your computer as a node in this giant attack this place. And it has nothing to do with your site. Your site wasn't even, like, directly targeted. It just, some malware found its way in. Yep. So, or maybe there's no indication at all, right? Like, again, we've seen malware sit dormant for a long time. And actually, I'm seeing a lot of this lately. I'll get into where. But, yeah, we've seen malware sit dormant for ages on these sites. Just waiting for instructions to stream in over the internet. So, I'll share a little story again as a segue into the next part of this talk. My team and I recently discovered a large number of sites that had vulnerable plugins and themes. And these are premium plugins and themes. These are paid plugins and themes. Not the ones you go to the .org repository to download. Software in question had some pretty nasty backdoor vulnerabilities in it, right? Like, they allowed the hackers to get in remotely. I'm not going to explain what, you know, all the technical details of that, but it didn't make sense, right? Because these are big name paid extensions. These are big name from companies you trust, right? Like, why are these hacked? We did a bunch of research, right? And then we discovered that people were acquiring these plugins and themes by going to their fancy Google and searching for free premium WordPress themes. Sounds like a completely logical thing to search for if you're looking for a free theme, right? Like, if you don't, you have no awareness of security. Sounds like a completely logical thing to search for, right? But however, if you break it down and contextualize it a little bit, like, you're essentially searching for pirated software here, and you're asking for trouble, right? So, they were led to these paid plugins and themes, and they're pretty nasty, laced with malware. So, most of you probably remember, there was a day when you could go online and get clean pirated software. Right, like, you want Photoshop, like, you could go download it. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, those days are gone, okay? Clean pirated software is a thing of the past. You cannot and will not find it anymore. Unless you go on some trusted, like, I'm sure there's something, but just assume you won't find it. Now, that includes paid premium WordPress plugins and themes, right? Like, this is software. Just like an executable you would install on your computer. Please don't ever install software, plugins, themes included, ever if it's from an untrusted source. It will contain malware, period. Remember earlier I said that every business is vulnerable, right? Or compromised already. I'm going to elaborate on that now. And it's not scary, but I was actually, another speaker told me earlier, like, if your security talk doesn't scare people, it hasn't been a very good security talk. So, I'm trying to be, like, totally freaked out by this, but I will bore you with technical details shortly. This is Roger Grimes. he works with Kevin Mitnick. I don't know if anybody knows Kevin Mitnick. He was a famous hacker in the 80s, like possibly the most famous hacker. Previous to that, he was a security consultant at Microsoft on the security team. Like, he's a big security guy. You Google this guy, you're going to find crazy stuff, right? So he's a freaking author on InfoWorld. He's a great guy. Microsoft does a lot more than create Windows, if you didn't know. They're often hired by businesses and government agencies to, you know, do penetration testing, like, to find where we're vulnerable, right? Roger is a really, really good hacker. He'll tell you he's not, but he's a really good hacker, world class. During a 20-year career, Roger has been hired to break into hundreds and hundreds of small, medium, large businesses, government agencies. Does anybody care to guess what his success rate has been? 100%, that's right. His team has infiltrated every single business and government agency that he has ever been hired to break into. And he'll tell you most of them were extremely easy. He said there was one that was particularly hard, and it was only hard because they had already been there. All the rest were unbelievably easy. This sounds unbelievable, I know. I actually called him up and I said, is this number actually correct? Like, elaborate, please. Like, it can't be 100%. He's like, no, it's 100%. It's actually simpler than you think, right? The vast majority of these cases involve a very specific attack vector I didn't mention earlier, or didn't elaborate on at least, the human element, social engineering. These are the effective methods in 2018 and will continue to be the effective methods. Okay. So what does any of this have to do with WordPress security? I mean, come on. Everything. So you can make your site as technically bulletproof as possible. And if your email is compromised, you're only, what, 2 clicks away from a password reset. Right? Like, this happens, right? Your social networks, your email, your phone, your instant messages, whatever. Once one's compromised, it's like, you know, an avalanche of things can go wrong. So I've given you the landscape. I want to give you some advice that you can take back to the real world to help keep you secure. And I'm betting that most of you have already heard most of this and just don't fully understand or, you know, need it elaborated. I'm going to do my best to do that. First of all, and possibly most importantly, choose your host wisely. Remember the numbers I brought up earlier. So 41%. Of successful attacks are on a host level vulnerability that you don't even have control over as a user of said host. Choose your host wisely. Generally speaking, this isn't always true, generally speaking, you get what you pay for with a host. Okay? Make sure they keep their server stack up to date. Make sure they do software updates. Okay? Remember, the software that you don't control could most likely be the vector that the hacker gets in on. You want your host to be diligent and reliable with those updates. Make sure they have system-level backups and a disaster recovery plan. We'll elaborate on those. Make sure you're doing daily, or better yet, real-time backups, right? Like, your host usually offers some sort of backups, but can you even get to them? Can you put your hands on that backup? Can you actually easily restore it, right? Like, test it before you need it. Nothing is worse than trying to recover an entire site from Google Cache. Ask me how I know. I recommend finding a WordPress-tailored backup and restore solution. Pay a few dollars for it if you must. There are plenty out there that are fantastic. Plug for Jetpack and Vaultdress. If you don't like Jetpack, there are plenty of others. Sure, go for it. Just get some backups. Keep your WordPress core plugins and themes up to date, right? Like, this is a given. When that little message pops up, there is an update available. It could very well be a security update, and it often is. The longer you wait, that's that time period, makes your site vulnerable. Update as soon as you can. Like, check as often as you can. Or use a managed service. There's a few out there. Like, Jetpack does it. WordPress.com. Jetpack does it. Managed WP. There's a couple others. I don't remember the names off the top of my head, but if you're not diligent about this, get one of those services. You use a malware scanner, right? Like, again, Jetpack. Or others. I'm not here to sell Jetpack, it's just what it works on, sorry. I want to see you safe regardless of what product you use, right? Like, just get yourself a good malware scanner, please. This one's a no-brainer, we already talked about. Use a strong password, a character sequence of letters, numbers, symbols that is adequately long and complex that it, there's a couple password tools. You could put in some crazy combinations and it's insane how quickly they can be cracked. Use a password manager, right? Like, personally, I use 1Password and I love it. There are others, LastPass. I think Google Chrome even has one built in. If you don't remember, a password manager is essentially a database of your passwords. You don't have to remember them, so they can be super long and super complex. And I've asked around in the security world because at first I was like, this sounds like a terrible vulnerability, leaving all of my passwords in one place, right? Like, that sounds awful. But I asked around in the security world, and the general consensus is that, like, the benefits far outweigh the possibility of a breach to that. And usually they're encrypted. Again, use a reputable name. Don't go download a free one. Use two-factor authentication. So a good two-factor solution will usually thwart all password cracking attempts. I'm not really going to spend any time on talking about what it is. Come find me after the talk if you don't know what two-factor is. I'm more than happy to explain it and help you. Or do a Google search, whatever. Find a solution. Reputable. This is a big one, and I don't know if it applies to really anyone in here, but if you have a site with a lot of users, like, maybe audit them, right? Like, do you need to have 17 administrators? Probably not. That's 17 accounts that you now need to keep secure. Less is more. Lastly, have a disaster recovery plan, right? Like, if you're a business owner, you probably already know kind of what this is. Like, a lot of insurances and stuff require them. In a nutshell, make sure you know exactly how you're going to respond to a disaster or, you know, a breach, whatever, hack. Know where your backups are. Again, please have tested them. Know exactly who to call if you need to call something. Test your plan frequently. I once had to restore a site from Google Cache because our backup system was literally backing up a snapshot of that database from like 2 months ago. If we had tested it, we would have seen that. Don't install untrusted software. We talked about this. It includes Photoshop or whatever on your local computer, but also includes plugins, non-official copies of WordPress. Be careful what you install on your web servers outside of WordPress. Right? Like, you're just writing a quick test program and you need to look at it in a web browser. Be careful about leaving that stuff. Because usually when you're testing something, it's pretty gnarly. So this is an interesting one. Hardware can be insecure also, right? Like, before you ever connect any device into your home or business network, like, take a few moments to think about whether it could have been compromised. And I say this, like, I contemplated whether it even had this, but I have a personal reason for saying this at this point. Maybe you saw the news recently, like, there was some, I don't know if it was legit or not, so sorry, but, like, there was news that some Chinese company had put some chips into servers that sent out to customers that allowed them to, you know, hack the servers essentially remotely. Again, I don't know if it was legit or not, but, like, this is possible, and given it's possible in the political landscape, don't you think it's probable that it is happening, right? I've seen hacked firmware on silly little devices like a security camera I bought for my home. Literally. It was an off-brand thing, ordered it off eBay or whatever. Had malware. Brand new from the factory. This is a real thing, folks. So a couple quick slides for the devs in the room. This is basics, but it's important. Validate, sanitize your inputs. You're accepting data in from the outside world into your computer program. You need to make sure that data is safe and it's not an attack payload. Okay? Absent is my favorite one. Want to take an integer? Make sure it's an integer. essentially just casts it into an integer, so you know you're getting a number. Sanitized text field for pretty much any data that's coming in from the outside world, right? That makes the vast majority of things safe to put in a database. Even if this data wouldn't be used in a context you might think is vulnerable, use these sanitization functions anyways. If you're accepting a static string in, use these sanitation functions. You never know who's going to go back and change some code somewhere. Use these functions. Trust me. Escape your outputs, okay? Anything being written to a web page should be escaped with proper escaping functions. ESC URL, ESC HTML, ESC ATTR, I think it is. Like, there's a bunch of them. I'll have a link at the end. Go look at the documentation for this stuff and use them. This ensures that exploited code that does somehow get in your database, or say you've got a known person that you've let log into your WordPress site and they put some malicious JavaScript in a post, this ensures that it doesn't get executed for every one of your visitors, right? This isn't talked about super frequently, but check your logic. Logic errors is a whole talk on its own. Hackers do take advantage of bad logic. Have someone else review your code, right? Like, or write your code together with somebody, peer programming. That's actually a lot of fun. I did that with a coworker recently. If that's not an option, write your code, sit on it for 24 hours. Review it yourself. Be amazed what you'll find in your code from yesterday. I believe Jonathan is going to talk about code review at like 2 p.m. Go check out his talk. It should be pretty good. I'm sure he's going to give you good advice. Lastly, the most secure code you write, maybe you didn't write at all, right? Don't make things unnecessarily complex, right? Leaf out what's unneeded. So, on the same note, a couple quick slides for like systems folks. I don't know if there are any in here. If you're going to set up your own hosting stack on AWS or whatever, use SSL. Again, make sure it's right. Because, again, nearly 50% of that top million sites is not using SSL or using it incorrectly. We all work in coffee shops or on the road or whatever from time to time. Right? If you don't use SSL on your site, you are streaming your password in plain text over the internet. Anyone can see what it is. There are free SSL. If you don't know what SSL is, it's HTTPS. You know, green check mark in your browser when you go to the site. It means your connection is encrypted, and usually means it's secure. There are free certificates out there. Take advantage of them. If you're not like a sysadmin, talk to your host, they can hook you up with an SSL certificate, usually at a very low cost, if anything. Make sure you do software updates regularly, right? Like MySQL, your web server software, your PHP software, even things you may not necessarily be using, like FTP servers, SSH, like whatever. Make sure you do your system updates. There are entire talks on all the little detail-y things that you can do, like changing WP salts, right? Like changing your table prefix, removing version numbers, fixing file permissions. All of those things are very important. You need to do them all, though. Like, don't leave a few things out. There are whole talks. Go to WordCamp.tv, find yourself a good talk on this. Know that you really need to do all of those little things. I'm going to leave you with a quote. Privacy is not for the passive, right? And I will also add that security is not for the passive either, right? Everyone that gets targeted by a real hacker gets compromised, okay? For everyone else, let's try to keep the robots out. So go check that out. Even if you already know about all this stuff, there's some really cool info on that site. Before is Roger Grimes' company, Kevin Nitton's company, Roger Grimes works for. If you want to do security awareness training for yourself or your business, like, these are the guys. Check them out. And the WordPress.org security page, like, it's got all kinds of cool links, useful things. Questions?
So you talked about password managers briefly,
sure.
And the importance of trusted versus untrusted software. What, in your opinion, are some really good and trusted password management tools that people could use?
So I prefer 1Password. It is a paid software. I think it's like $30 a year or something like that. But it's fantastic. Actually, it's even better than, like, if I had like one short password I could type in 2 seconds. Like, 1Password is better than that, right? Like, it's one click and you're into whatever site or service you need to. Your password database is like somehow secure. I don't know. I never really looked into it. There's a couple others. LastPass is good. They have Mac and Windows and probably Linux clients. I think Google Chrome has something built into the browser. I don't know how to get to it, but I can try to find out if you like. But I would recommend stay with LastPass or 1Password. I don't want to recommend something else. I don't know.
What about institutional password vaults?
I don't know a whole lot. I know what you're talking about. I can't speak to its efficacy.
We use one card vault at certain portions of the laboratory, and I love it. I don't have to keep up with all of that.
I know a little bit about that.
I do have to log into that site, and I have to remember that password.
Yeah, I know Vault is actually a really, really good product. A little more advanced than like most average users would take advantage of. But we actually use Vault for certain things. I don't know about the details. But. Yes?
So you said a couple times people are using SSL or they're using it improperly. Can you expand on what you mean by improperly? I mean, are you talking about you're not getting the little green lock, or what,
right.
what are you referring to?
So you can have an encrypted connection that's got something malformed in that connection, such that under the right conditions, a hacker could still see this data in plain text, or decrypt it for whatever reason. I don't personally know all of the details on how that's done. I do know it is a problem. For example, if you go to a site with an HTTPS, an SSL certificate, most of the time you're going to get a nice green check mark or whatever it is in whatever browser you're using. Sometimes you'll get like a grayed out check mark. That usually means something is broken. It is using SSL, it is encrypting, but there's something broken there and it could be a bad encryption, essentially. Does that answer that?
Do you recommend anything for two-factor authentication other than
WordPress?
Yeah.
Again, Jetpack.
Yeah.
There are a couple others. I think what they are. I wrote my own when I was at Mobile. It wasn't too bad. But I know there are a couple plugins. Just make sure. So go on the .org repository, search for two-factor.
Yeah.
Make sure you're using one that has like thousands and thousands of. Don't choose the one that has 14 users. And that's good advice for any plugin, right? Like, shy away from the ones that are, you know, don't get a lot of usage. So we're just about out of time.
One more question.
Sure, go ahead.
For sites that have a lot of subscribers, okay? So like a membership site, a site that has students on it, who won't have good password vaults is, what can we do for people that have a lot of members and subscribers on the site?
I would say probably in the interest of time, the first thing you should do, make sure that they only have access to the, check your roles and permissions for the subscriber user. Do an audit on that. Make sure they don't have access to things that they should. Generally speaking, the built-in WordPress. If you are not expanding on what WordPress is already doing, you're probably going to be a safe.
Okay.
Check your custom stuff, though. Okay. Get out of the way.